everyone, and welcome to our Healthy Eating Research 2022 virtual annual grantee meeting. I'm Mary Story, professor at Duke University and director of the Healthy Eating Research Program, a national program of the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, which is based here at Duke University. We are so glad to have you with us today from all across the country for our 16th annual meeting. And this is our plenary session on food and addiction, a review of the science and implications for research and policy. I'm excited about today's topic, and we are fortunate to have such a distinguished slate of experts, including our moderator, Dr. Margo Wootan, who I will introduce now, and then Margo will introduce the session, the panelists, and facilitate the discussion. Dr. Margo Wootan was named one of the most innovative women in food and drink by Fortune magazine and is one of the nation's top leaders in food and nutrition policy. She received her doctorate in nutrition from Harvard University School of Public Health. Margo was at the Center for Science in the Public Interest for 27 years, and when she left in 2020, she was vice president for nutrition and is now president of her own organization, MXG Strategies. I have known, admired, and worked with Margo for years. At CSPI, she did extraordinary and transformative policy work in improving nutrition for all Americans. For example, she led the movement to enact local, state, and national laws requiring calorie labeling on fast food and other chain restaurant menus. She led national efforts to improve school foods to get soda and unhealthy foods out of schools and have strong nutrition standards for school lunch, breakfast, and snacks. She also worked to require trans fat labeling on packaged foods, which contributed greatly to removing entirely trans fats from the US food supply. And she has also worked for years to reduce unhealthy food marketing aimed at children, as well as improved children's meals in restaurants. So if you look on our LinkedIn page, you'll see that she's received dozens of awards for her outstanding leadership in food and nutrition policy. Thank you, Margo, for moderating today's session, and I will turn it over to you.
Thank you so much, Mary, for that lovely introduction. And thank you to you and to Healthy Eating Research for hosting such interesting sessions this week. I greatly admire you and love working with Healthy Eating Research. You guys play such an important role in food and nutrition policy and changing the food system. This afternoon, we are going to explore the issue of food addiction. Some of you might be a little uncomfortable using the A word as it relates to food. So first, we'll review the science and how food addiction compares to addiction to tobacco, alcohol, and drugs. We're also going to explore how food companies exploit our instincts and our evolutionary biology to sell more food. And of course, we're going to address how we can address this problem through policy and system changes. So we're going to jump right in and hear first from Michael Moss, who is a Pulitzer Prize-winning investigative journalist. If you haven't read his new book, Hooked, Food, Free Will, and How the Food Giants Explore Our Addictions, I think after this session, hearing from him and the other panelists, you are likely to run right out and buy it. The book Hooked, as well as his previous book, Salt, Sugar, Fat, help us to better understand why it's just so incredibly hard to eat well and maintain a healthy weight. So, Michael, let me turn it over to you. Thank you.
Thanks, Margo. And thanks, everyone, for having me. And for you students out there, I've got like a 10-second cliff notes to what I'm going to say, or hopefully will say, so you can write this down. Yes, this stuff is addictive. You bet. The companies have known this for decades. And we might just be able to turn this knowledge to our advantage. My involvement, and this goes back to 2008, when I was in Algeria interviewing Islamic militants, and a couple of FBI agents showed up at the headquarters of the New York Times looking for me. I'd spent the previous 3 years traveling through the Middle East, first tormenting the Pentagon for failing to equip body armor to soldiers in Iraq, and then kind of writing critically about the war on terrorism throughout the Middle East. And somehow, according to the FBI, that I had managed to land myself on an Al-Qaeda hit list, which I only mentioned because when I came home on the next flight and began writing about something safer, processed food, it was like going from one war to another, not only in terms of the health consequences and the life and death aspect of it, but also in terms of kind of, you know, a huge industry figuring out how to exploit our vulnerabilities. In the case of the Iraq war, you had, you know, young soldiers needing a job, so they're joining the army, and then which then fails to deliver them something as simple as body armor because defense contractors were making so much money selling the Pentagon aircraft carriers. And then in terms of us, you know, we need to eat. And so the companies can figure it out that they could make the shopping, grocery shopping experience, you know, a minefield for us in terms of our ability to kind of figure out what's actually good for us and what's not. And I wanted to reiterate again, too, that I'm not a scientist, I'm not a researcher, I'm not even an advocate, I'm a journalist. And for this journey of mine, kind of into the underbelly of this processed food industry, I had really one burning question in mind, which is, how did we turn over something so critically important to us to 10 giant corporations with very little even government control over them? Or kind of put another way, how do we relinquish, you know, a homemade savory pot pie for that microwavable glop called the Hot Pocket? And as Margo mentioned, the first thing I did was to kind of delve into salt, sugar, fat as this unholy trinity in which the processed food industry relies on to get us to not just like their products, but to want more and more. I was incredibly lucky to come across a treasure trove of inside documents, sort of emails, white papers, memos, that put me at the heads of the largest companies as they were formulating, marketing, positioning their products in the stores and fast food restaurants. And it was those documents that enabled me to identify and then talk to key people in the industry who opened up and revealed even more secrets about what they did. And so much of what they did involved kind of the perfect engineering of those three ingredients. They have 60 kinds of sugar, which they perfect into what they call the bliss point for sweetness. They have 40 kinds of salt, which they call the flavor burst, because it's typically the first thing that the food touches on our tongue, sending the signal to the brain. And then, you know, they have lots of different kinds of oils, which provides that critical factor in highly processed food called the mouthfeel. And it's not just, as I discovered, kind of their perfection of using those three ingredients, both singularly and together. The companies marched around the store adding sugar and salt and fats to things that didn't used to have those ingredients, especially sugar, so that, you know, bread came to have added sugar and an engineered bliss point for sweetness. Some yogurts came to have the equivalent of a couple of tablespoons worth of sugar in a tiny half cup serving. And one of my favorite spots in the grocery store was the spaghetti sauce aisle, where, you know, a half cup of spaghetti sauce, some of the brands, had the equivalent of a couple of Oreo cookies worth of sugar. And arguably what that did was to teach us to expect sweetness in everything we eat. So when we drag ourselves over to that part of the store where every nutritionist says we should be spending more time, the produce aisle, and God help you if you have little kids that you're dragging over there, you're gonna have a riot on their hands, because we're all gonna be asking ourselves, where's the sugar in broccoli rabe and or broccoli? And I tried to end Salt, Sugar, Fat on a hopeful note, being a journalist. And I said something like at the end of the book, like, you know, hopefully this knowledge will, you know, in some way empower us to make better decisions about what to eat and how much. But immediately when the book came out, the very first question from a news reporter, and I think it was a British TV tabloid reporter, who said, "Michael, you know, you say here at the end that, you know, we can make our own decisions, but isn't this stuff you're writing about as addictive as drugs?" And I kind of like hemmed and hawed and backpedaled, because I had been avoiding the A word. I mean, it seemed ludicrous to me to compare Twinkies to heroin. I mean, whoever heard of somebody robbing a 7-Eleven for Doritos like someone might a pharmacy for opioids? But then something really interesting happened, which is all of the major companies began dialing back on their usage of salt, sugar, fat, in some cases rather significantly. And yet, arguably, our trouble with food was only continuing to go up. And so I thought to myself, wow, did I miss something here? Is this more than just salt, sugar, fat, and their other additives? Is there something about these products that can cause us to lose control that you don't even see on the label, that aren't an ingredient in the list of ingredients? And almost immediately, kind of in this now quest of mine to kind of look at that question, is it fair to look at to see these products as being addictive, as cigarettes, alcohol, even some drugs? And is there anything we can sort of gain from framing them in that fashion? I immediately got some really quick help from none other than Philip Morris, which at the time, for much of the 80s and the 90s and the early 2000s, was not only the largest tobacco cigarette manufacturer in North America, it was the single largest manufacturer of processed food through its purchase of the old company General Foods, and then Kraft, and then Nabisco, which makes Oreos. And those of you who've read Salt, Sugar, Fat know that Philip Morris played a really fascinating role in processed food, because not only did they loan all of their marketing genius to their processed food managers, they quietly turned to those food people and warned them way back in the year 2000 that they were going to face as much trouble over salt, sugar, fat, obesity, type 2 diabetes, as the tobacco managers were over smoking and cancer. And they urged their food managers to do something to lessen their dependency on salt, sugar, fat. But Philip Morris also did something really fascinating, which is that in the year 2000, after years and years of vehemently denying that processed food was addictive, they turned around and suddenly on a dime conceded that smoking was addictive. And when they did that, they turned to their scientists and their lawyers and everybody in-house who had built their whole careers arguing against addiction, and basically said to them, "You need to find some way to justify our about face on addiction." And so their own scientists kind of sat around and they go, "Well, God, how are we going to get out of this one?" And one of them kind of raises their hands and he goes, "Well, you know, maybe our out here is that the definition of addiction has changed over the years. I mean, it used to be, you know, with drugs that you would have to have painful withdrawal symptoms, or you'd have to have sort of a moving threshold where you needed more and more drugs to sort of get the high. But that's changed as our understanding of the effects of drugs and stuff has changed, because not all addictive drugs or drugs with addictive properties cause withdrawal symptoms or tolerance limit changes." So they were looking for, like, in fact, I mean, now the definition of addiction, and they found for themselves kind of what they thought that was the perfect modern day definition of addiction. And it was coined by their own CEO in the year 2000, during some legal proceedings, when he was asked to say, "Hey, what's your definition of addiction?" And he said, "Addiction is a repetitive behavior that some people find difficult to quit." And I thought that was so valuable to me, because knowing about Philip Morris's history as being the single largest processed food manufacturer, I thought that was a fitting definition, not only for smoking, but for many of its biggest icons that it sold in the grocery store as well. The other thing I did kind of immediately too, being a journalist, is I put myself in the shoes of the processed food manufacturers to try to get a sense of how they would defend themselves from the addiction charge. And there's this beautiful white paper that a legal firm that works for the industry prepared as a defense to litigation accusing them of creating and marketing addictive substances. And there were kind of like three main points that they made. And I got help from scientists in kind of looking at these points from a different perspective. So one of their defenses is that, where's the harsh chemical in Oreo cookies or Hot Pockets, the kind of chemical that you might find in, you know, in harsh illegal narcotics? And one of the realizations, of course, is that our own brain creates chemicals that attract us to substances, some of them very, very close in resemblance to these chemicals that you do find in addictive drugs. The other defense of theirs was, well, look, I mean, look at two brain scans of people, right? One, you know, clearly, you know, wired on cocaine, and the other eating Twinkies, you know. Clearly the one on drugs is going to look, you know, much more vivid brightness in terms of showing the brain lighting up in response to that substance. But as someone pointed out to me, that in contrast to drugs, food doesn't require much to get us to act impulsively. And the reason for that is it's cheap, it's everywhere, it's convenient. And so the wow factor in food doesn't have to be nearly what it does, what it has to be in sort of drugs, which are illegal and scary. And you need, you know, a lot of excitement in the brain to sort of get you to sort of commit to a narcotic versus food. And then the other thing too, that one of the defenses is that, well, wait a minute, not everyone like loses control over ding dongs and Hot Pockets and Lunchables. So how can you blame us if only some people lose control? And of course, that goes back to the Philip Morris definition, which is, you know, only, you know, that some people can't control repetitive behavior. And I think that's really key in what I learned in spending time with scientists who used to study drugs and then turned to studying food, is that kind of the drug addiction world is filled with people who don't fit the stereotype of a drug addict. They can use even heroin casually without feeling the pain and the situation and the effects of being addicted to the drug. And don't get me wrong, there are many reasons to avoid using heroin, even in a casual setting, even if you're kind of one of those people. But that knowledge that addiction happens on a spectrum and affects some people much differently than others, irrespective of the product itself, and that's an accepted understanding of addiction in the drug and alcohol and tobacco world, I think is really critical. And then the last hurdle that I had to get over as a journalist was kind of the pushback, okay, but where's the lost control, right? Where's the blind groping for, you know, the cigarettes, where you're not even able to sort of think in terms of stopping yourself? And I think that we see that at one end of the spectrum with food. It's called binging. But my sense is that, and my definition of sort of loss of control with food, is at the other end of the spectrum, where you have us becoming dependent on these food products in a way that we never intended to in the first place, and kind of slowly, gradually, incrementally losing control day by day. And of course, even those slow, gradual loss of controls can lead to obesity and type 2 diabetes. And at the end of kind of that questioning, I really kind of came to the conclusion that in some ways kind of food is the mother of all addictions, because someone else pointed out to me that even harsh drugs don't hijack our brains as much as they're using the neurological systems that are in place to get us to be attracted to food, which kind of led me to meeting Dana Small. She's a neuroscientist at Yale. Fabulous work. She was the first person to slide people into an fMRI and figure out how to get them to eat so she could see the effect that was having on their brain through the brain scans without chewing. Being a self-professed chocoholic, right? Dana figured out that she could put squares of milk chocolate on her subjects' tongues and slide them in the machine and have them just sort of press down or press up the chocolate to the roof of the mouth, and it would melt and ooze over their taste buds and create that mouthfeel. And Dana was the first person to sort of see and produce those fabulous brain scans of us on food. But she would kind of push back to me on the concept of addiction a bit. And she said, you know, Michael, as you know, it's not so much from my perspective that food is addictive as much as we by nature are drawn to food. And the food companies have so dramatically changed the nature of our food and our eating that our biology hasn't had a chance to catch up. And even by nature, for most of our existence, overeating was a really good thing because we couldn't do it very often. It was the thing that enabled us to survive and get through droughts and famines, right? But the companies, through ways we can talk about, you know, have so dramatically changed our food environment that overeating has become an everyday thing. And we haven't had time in the last 50 years to develop kind of the biological, genetic, you know, defenses against overdoing it, over losing control of these food products. So Dana Small kind of looks at what we're talking about as this kind of great biological mismatch between us and the way that we're designed to be attracted to food and the way that the companies have learned to exploit that. And so let's talk about kind of three things that the companies do. We by nature are attracted to food that's cheap, as in food that requires the least energy expenditure on our part. Go back to hunter-gatherer societies, it's why they learn to, instead of chasing down the impala for dinner, just to reach down and grab that poor aardvark sitting there, because it meant less energy expenditure on their part, and that's what survival is all about in that situation. So what do the food companies do? They hire flavor labs, which are chemical laboratories, to mix and match chemical substitutes for their food products with the overarching goal of finding combinations of those chemical ingredients that reduce the cost of those food products, because they know when we walk into the store and that box of breakfast toaster pastries is 10 cents less than it was last week, our brain's going to get instinctually really excited about that. We by nature are drawn to variety in food. It's kind of the reason why humans were able to move around the globe and get excited about whatever there was to eat in that part of the world, even if it was whale blubber in the Arctic. And so what do the companies do to exploit that? That's why we have the cereal aisle with 200 versions of sugary sweetness there, pretending to give our brain and exciting the brain with the pretense of variety, because that's one of our basic instincts. And maybe the most powerful instinct that we have for food is that we're attracted to calories. We have sensors in the gut, possibly on the tongue, that tell us how many calories there are in the food or the drink that we're having. And the more calories there are, the more we get excited about that. And so for most of our existence, finding things that had lots and lots of calories was the ticket to our survival. And so what did the food companies do? They started to make these products, especially snacks, loaded with calories. And in their case, these were nutritionally empty calories because they knew that we will, by instinct, get excited by those calories. I mentioned that the companies have known this, and you can see that through the memos and the emails and the white papers and this kind of design of their products. But it's kind of been even more blatant. 2003, Kraft, one of those companies that Philip Morris bought and then sold off in the mid-2000s, decided that it wanted to do something on behalf of consumers and change the way that the label looked in order to tell people just how the total number of calories in these packages of snacks it was designing, where they would put four or five servings in the package. And as a way of kind of justifying this move, and that was a good thing on the part of Kraft doing from a consumer perspective, but to justify that, they went to the FDA and they did some research on how many people lose control over those five serving packages and eat the whole thing in one serving. And the number that Kraft came up with, just asking people to volunteer and confess that information, was basically 1 in 3 people were saying that they lost control of that food product to the extent that they would eat the whole thing, 5 servings in 1 serving. Kraft knew this back in 2003. I was lucky to meet the general counsel of Philip Morris, a guy named Steve Parrish, who, when we sat down and chatted, he said to me at one point, you know, Michael, I'm sorry, I'm playing with this cigarette, but I can't help it, because he would do that too. He goes, I was one of those people who could, lucky people, he said, who could smoke 1 cigarette a day, put it back in the package, and then not have any compulsion to pull out the pack again and have another smoke until the very next day and probably the next business meeting. But remember, this is the time that his company, Philip Morris, owned Nabisco, which made Oreos. But he said, Michael, I couldn't go anywhere near a package of Oreos for fear of losing control and eating half the bag in one sitting. For a journalist, that kind of insider knowledge about how powerful these products can be for some people, for many people, is just golden in terms of understanding this industry's culpability and responsibility. And then lastly, right before the pandemic, the current owner of Oreos put out this instructional video helping people who ate too many Oreo cookies, like Steve Parrish, the general counsel of Philip Morris, who would eat the whole package. And it's the most amazing video, you can find it yourself on the web, that I've ever seen. I mean, this very serious looking nutritionist is going through the things that she's urging people to do. And I think step number 8 was take a big dinner plate, put 3 Oreo cookies on it, only 3, and pick up just 1 of those cookies at a time, take a nibble out of it, put it back on the plate before you eat anymore. And my own wife was like watching that. She's going like, God, there's no way I could do that. But the point being that the maker of Oreos having, again, this insider knowledge that a good many people lose control over its products, actually put out something that it thought would help us regain control over our eating habits. You have to take a look at it. So point 3, lessons. I think one of the beautiful things about framing food from an addiction standpoint, framing processed food, highly processed food, is that I think there are kind of some lessons that we can draw from the world of other addictive substances that might sort of help us deal with food. And again, thinking about food on a spectrum, if you're somebody who loses control over Oreo cookies or Lunchables or what have you, you're probably going to have to sort of do what people addicted to certain drugs do, which is to abstain. I mean, do not bring those cookies or snacks into your house because you know what's going to happen. You have to go cold turkey. You have to just completely avoid them in your life. If you're somebody further down the spectrum, who's maybe trouble with food is more getting like a 3 p.m. craving for a sugary snack, I think the lesson from the world of drug addiction is that cravings come on so strong and so hard and overwhelm the brain's ability to sort of help you think through that moment and put the brakes on an action that you really don't want to do, that you have to get ahead of it. And so whether your strategy is to get up and stretch or walk around the block or call a friend or have something healthy like a handful of nuts, you probably need to be executing that strategy at like 2:55 in order to ward off that 3 p.m. craving, which will cause you to run for that snack and be unable to sort of control it. And then the last thing I think that we can learn from the world of other addictive substances is that one of the hallmarks of addiction is speed. The faster a substance can hit the brain, the more apt we are to respond and to react kind of impulsively. And I go through the ways that the processed food, in my view, is some of the most fastest, quickest stuff out there in the world of addictive substances. But the counter to speed is to slow down. And I think that's why it makes so much sense when you hear people talk about cooking as an antidote to losing control over processed food, because it slows us down. It gets us thinking about the food. It gets the digestive juices going before we're actually putting something in our mouth. It sort of prepares the brain for that incoming rush of flavor. And I think that's one of the most beautiful ways we can turn the tables on these companies, which is to sort of use that understanding of speed being a really problematic factor in processed food to our advantage in finding ways to slow down. And I'm going to stop there and thank you for listening. And I'm really looking forward to your questions.
Thank you so much, Michael. That was really interesting. I'm excited for the Q&A. And we're going to hear more about the science next from Dr. Ashley Gearhardt, an associate professor at the University of Michigan and one of the leading experts in food addiction.
Hi, everyone. I'm so thrilled to be here to speak with you today and to be on this panel with Dr. Wootan and Michael Moss and Dr. Brownell is just such an honor. So thank you so much for inviting me. And I'm going to be speaking with you today about the science of food and addiction that my lab and other labs have been looking into. So you can go to the next slide. So I like to start this talk when we consider, you know, can certain foods be addictive, by thinking about how have we determined whether anything is addictive in the past? And I think one of the biggest misunderstandings that people typically have is that we have some sort of objective biological marker or chemical signature that if it's present, it tells us something's addictive. And we just do not have that for any addictive drug. Instead, the decision has really been based on the ability of these substances to trigger specific psychological and behavioral responses in some people. And so what I'm going to share with you today is I'm going to use tobacco as a potential benchmark, and I'm going to share with you the scientific criteria that were included in the 1988 Surgeon General's report, which is essentially the watershed moment when tobacco was identified as addictive. And I'm going to go through the criteria that were determined to be sufficient to show that tobacco was an addictive substance and should be treated as that, even though there was a lot of debate around whether a substance that was legal, easily accessible, and non-intoxicating could really be an addictive substance. So next slide. So the first criteria that was used in the Surgeon General's report was that tobacco use in some individuals could trigger compulsive use. And by that, I mean it could trigger an inability to stop despite a desire to do so or in the face of negative consequences. And clearly we see that with tobacco, with people, you know, wanting to quit, not being able to, or having lung cancer and still smoking. But as Michael, I think, did such a nice job explaining, you know, we're clearly seeing this on a societal level as well with our ultra-processed food intake. We see that people are gaining weight excessively and are still unable to cut down on their ultra-processed food intake. We see that when people get diagnosed with diet-related disease like type 2 diabetes and are told to alter their ultra-processed food intake, the majority of individuals are unable to follow that medical advice, even though it is a life-threatening condition. And for any of those of us who have a clinical practice, if you're working with someone who has lost control over their intake of ultra-processed food, the distress is incredibly high and the desire to change this is also very notable and the motivation is high. And yet many people struggle to actually change their intake. Next slide, please. So as part of my research, we've worked to develop a specific tool to try and really objectively identify individuals who are showing a compulsive addictive phenotype in their eating behavior. And to do this, we've applied the core diagnostic criteria that we use to identify any substance addictive disorder, and we've then applied that to the intake of food. And so some of those symptoms are loss of control over intake, intense cravings, inability to cut down despite a desire to do so, continuing to use in the same way despite having negative health or mental health consequences. We also assess symptoms that aren't required, like tolerance, needing more and more, or withdrawal, experiencing irritability, agitation, enhanced cravings when you try and cut down on the substance. We assess this by administering a 35-item survey where people report the frequency of specific indicators of each of these symptoms. And at the end, you can really score this in two ways. You can either see how many symptoms is someone experiencing from 0 to the 11 symptoms that are available, and you can identify a diagnostic threshold that really mirrors the diagnostic threshold for substance use disorders, which is 2 or more symptoms in the past 12 months or with clinically significant impairment or distress. So 2 or more symptoms plus clinically significant impairment or distress is the diagnostic threshold for meeting for an addictive phenotype. Next slide, please. So when we've looked at the Yale Food Addiction Scale, we've looked at our threshold for addictive eating, what we've seen is that in clinical samples with overweight, obesity, disordered eating, mental health conditions like depression, meta-analyses have found that about 1 in 3 adults are meeting for this food addiction phenotype. When we look at community samples of non-clinical adults, we see that the threshold is at about 14%. And that number is very striking to me because if we look at the estimate of alcohol use disorder and tobacco use disorder, it's also estimated at 14% for each of those legal, easily accessible addictive substances. Now, when we pivot and we look at children, and samples of children with overweight, about 1 in 5 meet this food addiction threshold. And again, looking at a community non-clinical sample of children, it's at about 12%. And if we contrast that to substances like alcohol and tobacco, this is much higher than what we see with those other addictive substances, because of course, children are not getting exposed to and having access and being heavily marketed to for alcohol and tobacco products at this time. Next slide. So we've now been able to identify this compulsive addictive phenotype, but the question is it really valid? And so the way that myself and others have really looked at this is to say, we know there's certain core mechanisms that are underlying all addictive disorders. And if we look at individuals who are showing addictive eating, do they also show problems in these same mechanistic pathways? And so we've seen that food addiction is associated with intense inhibitory control difficulties, reward dysfunction, particularly with enhanced reward response in the brain to food cues, and emotion dysregulation and a tendency to use food as a way to try and cope with extreme emotions. And so again, we're kind of seeing this validity that mechanisms that we see in other addictive substances, other addictive disorders are also associated with food addiction. But we also wanted to say, well, does this tell us anything clinically? And what we have seen ourselves and others is that food addiction symptoms are associated with a poor treatment outcome in weight loss treatments and disordered eating treatments. Actually, the Diet Fits trial, which has hundreds of adults going through weight loss treatment, found that food addiction was the best psychosocial predictor of a tendency to drop out of treatment or to gain weight rather than lose it during their weight loss treatment trial. We also see that food addiction, but not body mass index, has been associated with lower quality of life across all domains, suggesting this is a clinically relevant phenotype. Next slide, please. So, when we first started doing this work, we called it food addiction because we really didn't have specific science to kind of really help us hone in on what sorts of foods might be triggering this process. But my lab has really focused a lot more recently on what foods specifically are implicated in this addictive phenotype. And Dr. Erica Schulte, who's now a faculty at Drexel, has played a large role in this research. And again, we've looked to addictive drugs to understand what makes a certain drug more or less addictive. And so as Michael did a great job explaining in his presentation as well, substances that deliver an increased dose of an addictive agent like nicotine are more prone to be addictive. And very, very importantly, how rapidly that substance is absorbed into the system is a key indicator of how addictive it is. So if you have something like a nicotine patch that has a slow release of a lower dose of nicotine, people don't seem to get addicted to that. But when you have industrial cigarettes, which have been optimized to give a high dose at a rapid rate of absorption, many people will start to lose control of that. And so when we look at the ultra processed foods in our environment, we see that many of them are delivering increased elevated doses of rewarding ingredients like sugars and fats, and their food matrix has been altered where fiber and water and protein and texturizers have been added to give them a way that they're eaten very rapidly and they're absorbed into our gut in a much more rapid way than naturally occurring foods. And so our hypothesis was that these ultra processed foods, but not minimally processed foods, would be those that were people were prone to eat in this addictive manner. And so to investigate that, we have had people fill out the Yale Food Addiction Scale and then ask them to make forced choice between different foods to say which ones are most likely to trigger this sort of behavior in you. And so now I'll show the results with you. Next slide. So these are the top 10 of the foods that people report having a tendency to consume in this addictive way. And I don't think these results are a shock to anyone. These are chocolate, ice cream, French fries, pizza, all foods, ultra processed foods that are created by the industry that are very commonly available to us. And all of these foods have high levels of both refined carbohydrates and fats, and that doesn't seem to really occur in minimally processed foods. This unique combining of high levels of refined carbohydrates and fats is really a unique experience in the ultra processed foods that we're now exposed to. But all of these foods are also altered in a way where there isn't a lot of fiber, isn't a lot of water. We can eat them so rapidly, and the degree to which the sugars and the fats are being absorbed into our system is much more rapid. Next slide, please. When we see what foods are at the bottom of the list, you know, it's not surprising that it's minimally processed foods. Apple, banana, and salmon. People are just not binging on a bushel full of bananas like they are a bag of potato chips. And I think it's notable here that many of these foods do have high levels of carbohydrates like an apple or a banana, or high levels of fat like salmon, but the way that they are delivered into the system is so distinct from what we see with those ultra processed foods that people are not prone to consume them in an addictive manner. So it's really about those ultra processed foods that seem to trigger this experience. Next slide, please. The next criteria that was used to identify that tobacco was addictive is that it was psychoactive. And this is defined as causing transient effects on mood as mediated by the brain. And so we've looked in our own research to see to what degree are these foods leading to increases in pleasure or reducing negative mood in a way that's comparable to what we see with tobacco. And what you can see here are some results from some qualitative work where people are reporting, you know, for me, the main emotional outcome of eating is the intense pleasure while it's happening. The emotional thing is big. I eat this stuff to feel better. When we ask people, what foods are you eating to alter your mood? It's all the ultra processed stuff. It isn't fruits and veggies. Next slide, please. And when we look at the brain, work by Dana Small and Alex D. Felicentonio are really identifying that how carbohydrates and fats are impacting us and the metabolic signals that they're including in the gut are then going up through our pathways and activating the striatum in the brain. And the striatal section of the brain is where dopamine is released. And this is a key part that's associated with reward and motivation and is the brain region that's most strongly implicated in addictive disorders and that addictive substances are capable of activating strongly. If you go to the next slide, please. Here, what I'm showing you is the degree to which addictive substances like ethanol and nicotine lead to dopamine release in the striatum. And compared to baseline, they lead to about 150 to 200% increase in magnitude of dopamine release. Next slide, please. What I'm showing you here are the same results of how ultra-processed foods like these Fonzies, which are essentially like Italian Cheetos, lead to striatal dopamine release, and sucrose lead to striatal dopamine release. And when you look at that, the magnitude of the dopamine release in the striatum is in that 150% to 200% range. And so here, what I'm showing you is that the magnitude of the brain change that's most implicated in addiction that's triggered by ultra-processed foods and ingredients in those like sucrose are comparable to that magnitude of release for nicotine and ethanol. So clearly these foods are both impacting the brain and leading to changes in mood. Next slide, please. The final criteria that was used in the Surgeon General's report was that tobacco was highly reinforcing, meaning animals would administer it, they would choose it over other reinforcing substances. And what we saw with tobacco and nicotine in particular is that it isn't the strongest reinforcer. If you compare it to cocaine, time and time again, animals will almost never choose nicotine over cocaine. But what I'm showing you here is an evaluation of how reinforcing sweet tastes are to animals. And what you can see in figure B here is that when an animal was forced to choose between cocaine or a sweet taste, and these are animals who are even showing signs of dependency on cocaine, almost 100% of the time, they would choose the lever that delivered the sweet taste. If we identified the animals by what they preferred more, sweet taste or cocaine, only one of the animals preferred cocaine over sweet taste. One animal was kind of ambivalent, and the rest would overwhelmingly choose the sweet taste over cocaine. So what this is demonstrating is that sweet taste and the sort of things we get delivered from ultra-processed foods in our environment are highly, highly reinforcing substances. Next slide, please. So what I hope I've shown you today is that if we use scientifically determined benchmarks that we use to resolve the last controversy over whether a substance that was legal and easily accessible, but killing hundreds of thousands of people each year was not just a bad habit, but truly addictive, that ultra-processed foods meet all of these criteria. And so in my lab, we're really trying to move towards really thinking about ultra-processed foods, not so much as a food, but as a man-made substance that's highly rewarding and prone to trigger addictive responses. And so we're trying to use more psychopharmacology methods to understand and really disentangle what is it about these substances and the combinations of sugars and fats and additives that really are triggering these responses. I think a key future direction is to investigate how this is impacting early developing brains of children and also in utero, because you know, we're seeing this widespread activation and response in children. And then finally, my lab's looking at food insecurity as another potential factor that's implicated in food addiction. So I want to leave you with this thought experiment, as you know, I've kind of showed you this evidence that ultra-processed foods are contributing to hundreds of thousands of preventable deaths each year. They're consumed compulsively by some people. They're craved intensely. They trigger dopamine release in the same magnitude as nicotine and ethanol, and they're highly reinforcing. So given all of that evidence, you know, what is our evidence that these ultra-processed foods are not addictive? If we flip it on our head, what is the strength of evidence of that? And I always leave it with, if these ultra-processed foods were new pharmaceutical products, they would fail safety testing due to having a high addictive potential with little health benefit. So I think it's time to really change our thinking about these ultra-processed foods. Thank you very much for the time. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much. We could talk about this for hours more, and luckily we'll have some time at the end for questions. I see some people are already putting their questions in the Q&A, and both Megan and I recommend a really terrific review that Dr. Gearhardt has pulled together. So if you're looking for more science, more background, more studies, that's a good place to start. So we're going to turn it over next to Dr. Kelly Brownell, who is the director of the World Food Policy Center at Duke University. Like on so many issues, Dr. Brownell was way ahead of the rest of us in warning about the dangers of food addiction, and it's an issue that he's given a lot of thought to, and is going to share some of his ideas with us today. Thank you so much, Dr. Brownell. You're up next.
Thank you, Margo. I really appreciate the introduction. What a pleasure it is to be on the panel with Michael and Ashley. I expected that they would give powerful and compelling presentations, and they did. And there's so much then to talk about in terms of legal and policy implications. If I might have the next slide. We began thinking about this issue of food and addiction some years ago, and I got to thinking about it first because I started reading some papers by people who were working in the addiction field, not in the nutrition field, but the addiction field, who were interested in the issue of food and addiction. And I got in touch with Mark Gold, a psychiatrist at the University of Florida, and invited him to Yale, where I was at the time. And we put together a conference that took place in 2007 on this. And you'll see the person, the third from the left in the front row, was a graduate student at the time, Ashley Gearhardt, and look what she's done, become a giant in the field. So the conference took place in 2007. We followed that, if I could have the next slide, with a book that was published now about 10 years ago on food and addiction, where we brought together the available science on the topic. We concluded from this, that in the next slide, in the final chapter of the book, these things that it seemed scarcely in question at the time, given the available science, that this was the food and addiction was a viable concept, and that food can act on the brain like an addictive substance, and in so doing has created a public health menace. And this is 10 years ago, and there's so much science that's occurred since that time that I think these things can be said with even more certainty now, and Ashley and Michael pointed that out beautifully. So the question is, why has it taken us so long to be doing things like this symposium, given that the interest in this goes way back? And I think it's just historical. The first people to be studying this issue came from the addiction field, as I mentioned. People like Mark Gold, who was a psychiatrist at the University of Florida, the chair of psychiatry there, Nora Volkow, also does work in the psychiatry area, is now the head of the National Institute on Drug Addiction, have been studying this way before people in our field got interested in it. So I think it's just taken its time to catch up to them. And now we are, and I don't know that we're caught up, but at least we're catching up. And that's evidence of that is the fact that the symposium is taking place. So I think it's really important that this work get discussed in more detail, more research gets done, and we understand the implications of this. So the next slide, please, raises this interesting question of, does the science justify legal and policy action? And my response to that is heck yes. There's such important information that's available on the damages of the consumption of these foods. Industry culpability is becoming more clear. Michael's book has helped a lot with that. And the question is, if we're going to take legal or policy action, why should we do this? And what sort of actions could be justified? And so I think begin asking where the industry is vulnerable is important. And the things that have been discussed already are the health consequences of consuming the products that the industry produces, the intentional formulation that drives overconsumption, the targeted marketing of these, and which parts of the industry portfolio or market most aggressively becomes important. And then, of course, there are a whole series of things about how industry sets portion sizes, uses pricing incentives, et cetera. Excuse me, if you go to the supermarket, there are lots of pricing incentives to buy bigger containers of sugared beverages, snack food, cereals, and things like that. If you're buying Brussels sprouts or broccoli or celery or lettuce or apples, there's no incentive to buy more of something because it's not going to cost you any less. So I think industry is vulnerable on a number of fronts. And just to give you an example of this, if you look at the next slide, it shows work from the Rudd Center on marketing of cereals to children. And these are the 10 most frequently marketed children cereals marketed on TV. Now, these companies that market these cereals also have healthier products in their portfolio, but that's not what they're marketing to children. And the next slide shows, for example, the use of logos that get attached to the least healthy products in the company's portfolio. So if industry is culpable for attracting children, in particular to these foods, you can see a lot of ways that they're doing it. Pricing, portion sizing, use of popular logos like Tony the Tiger attached to the foods that are going to cause the most damaging consequences from both a health perspective and an addiction perspective. It's interesting, and Michael talked about the industry knowing this for a long time, and I think that's absolutely true. And the next slide shows that in some ways, they not only admit this to be the case, but they kind of brag about it. They embrace these concepts of addiction in their marketing. And so the next slide shows, for example, the issue about craving. And here this company is talking about the craving of this particular product. And of course, craving is an important part of defining addiction. The next slide shows the same concept being applied by a different company. The next slide shows the same company, but marketing different things. In this case, some outside the US. In embracing this idea of craving. And the next slide shows this sort of to an extreme where you've got craving, but perhaps all, tolerance, perhaps this alludes to withdrawal, that, you can't just eat one of these things. And it's interesting the juxtaposition of the Garden of Eden and then the devil on the right, as the companies are talking about not being able to eat just one. So it's possible that the industry will show culpability through its own marketing practices, but there are, of course, a lot of other things they're doing that could be relevant. The next slide, please, leads to this issue of strategic decision. So given that we may believe that something should be done on the policy or legal front, what do we do? And there are some very interesting decisions to be made. I mean, one is to think about whether we're going to make more progress on the policy front or the legal front. Now, if you think about the three branches of government, we can think about whether food industry behavior has been changed by regulation. Well, there have been a few victories with, for example, labeling advances. But for the most part, regulatory agencies have not cut down on the food industry pushing their products, formulating the products, and manipulating the way they sell their products in order to maximize consumption. We can look at the legislative branch of government. Well, there have been some legislative victories. Soda taxes would be an example of that. There are a number of legislative things that Margo and others have worked on that have been important victories. But those and the regulatory things have mainly fallen in the category of, we're going to let the food industry do what it wants, not interfere with it too much, but see if we can curtail its impact by informing consumers through labeling, or we'll put soda taxes out there so we'll drive up the price. We're not going to change whether the industry sells it or how it markets it or how available it is. We're just going to push up the price. So these things are not really having much of an impact on industry behavior as far as I can see. And from what I was hearing from Michael and Ashley, I'm assuming they would agree that the industry is marching ahead pretty much unimpeded with the way they're formulating and selling their products. So that leaves the last branch of government, the judicial branch, and that leads to the possibility of legal action. And is this a place where litigation might ultimately be a powerful tool? That all has to be worked out. There are discussions of that occurring, but I would urge us as a field not to overlook that as a possible means of intervention to address this key issue. And certainly there are precedents with tobacco, automobile safety, et cetera, where litigation has been a very important tool, in some cases brought about by recognition that the other branches of government were not doing enough to protect us from corporate misbehavior. The next slide raises what I think is an interesting question about what phenomenon is it we're trying to explain. And there's a key use of the word, and Ashley's heard me say this forever, the word and. So if you talk about food addiction or you talk about food and addiction, it sort of implies a subtle change in meaning that I think might be ultimately important. So the next slide would show what sort of stereotypically is thought of as, somebody binge eating, somebody eating large amounts of something out of control to the point where they might suffer pretty serious consequences. And so if you ask somebody, what might a food addict do, it conjures up images like this. But the next slide shows what might ultimately be a more important phenomenon, which is too much consumption of unhealthy foods, but in seemingly normative ways. So if these kids are getting off school and they're wanting a sugared beverage, why is that occurring? Is it simply because they like the taste? Is it because they've been marketed to very aggressively? Or is it because, and or is it because these products are hijacking their brain and they're getting craving and withdrawal and tolerance and those sort of things that make them consume enough of these beverages to be a public health menace, but not necessarily to classify as a sort of a binge and things, or somebody going to the drive-in would be an example. So it's important, I think, in the communication about this issue that we explain the phenomenon that we're talking about, that this applies to everybody, the normal run-of-the-mill person who is consuming more of these beverages or foods that are optimal for health. And why is that? And is the brain involved? Are the companies culpable for manipulating the ingredients of foods to trigger this process, et cetera? So you could have a big public health impact by having a massive impact on a small number of people. That would have been the previous slide, or a smaller effect on a much larger number of people. And that would be represented by this particular slide. The next slide raises another interesting question. And you know, I noticed that Ashley was talking a lot about ultra-processed foods. Now, my guess is that if the talk had been given 5 or 6 or 7 years ago, it would have been about sugar more than ultra-processed foods. And that's because the work on ultra-processed foods has marched ahead in a very steady way. The result is very compelling. So I think Ashley is absolutely justified in focusing on that rather than what used to be the case, sugar. But it's an interesting question about, should we make this decision, and the field will face it, about what do we talk about? Do we talk about sugar? Do we talk about ultra-processed foods? If lawsuits are going to be filed, what should be the target? And that becomes a very interesting question. There's a scientific answer to that, and the scientific answer would lead you down the road that Ashley was discussing today, which is to focus on ultra-processed food. But is this sort of a legal and policy question? Which would have, you know, what should the target be if you want to have legs in a policy setting or in a legal setting? So if you look at legal definitions of addiction, for example, then what should the focus be? Will the data predominate on, say, sugar, on ultra-processed food, on some combination of factors like sugar, fat, and salt, et cetera? And these are very interesting questions. And then there's also the strategic question about if the idea of doing something to crack down on food industry behavior because of addiction, if we want to generate maximum public support for that, then what will be the frame that will create greatest public support? And that's, so I think this focus on ultra-processed foods is really a good one, but it's going to take some more selling, because people get it when you talk about sugar. Ultra-processed food is a more difficult to understand concept. So the next slide raises interesting questions about what the industry will do. And the next slide shows that if you try to predict the industry response, which is, you know, not always easy to do, but I think it can be done because of looking at precedents with tobacco. And I think writings like what Michael has done point this out. The industry's response is probably pretty predictable. And these are the things that they're likely to do. So the question is, can you get in and preempt the industry from doing these things, create a shield against them, and be able to counter these when specific policy or legal things are done based on the addiction concept? The next slide asks the question is, does industry perceive a threat here? This is a quote actually that I got from the other panelists from an earlier conversation we had that was the Tobacco Institute document, that the tobacco industry certainly saw the concept of addiction to be a major threat to their business. And Michael is indicating that the food industry is probably thinking the same way. And so if the industry is perceiving that as a threat, it means that they're worried about the accumulating science, but also about the policy and legal vulnerability they have. And the next slide which is my final one, shows the paper, the journal article that Michael referred to, and he was kind enough to send this to me, that was a specifically written piece to tell the industry, what do you do to fight off claims about poor nutrition, obesity, and health? And addiction has a very interesting section in this. So in summary, it seems to me that the science now is indisputable. It was a number of years ago, it certainly is now, and that it provides a very strong basis for taking policy and legal action. The question is, what actions should be taken? Should they be policy? Should they be legal actions? Should they be both in concert with one another? And if so, then what are the strategic questions the field needs to address? What are the scientific questions? What are the communications and public relations questions that need to be addressed in order to create maximum benefit for the public, given what we know from the science? So thanks again for including me in this. I really enjoyed the conversation.
Thank you so much, Dr. Brownell. And thank you to all of our speakers who are now going to join us. And we have a lot of questions. We're going to start with one that we've hit on, but I think would be good to have each of you address a little bit more again. You don't often hear policymakers and even advocates using the term food addiction and using it as a rationale for food policies. Which do you think is a bigger barrier, the state of the science or a lack of understanding of the existing science?
Happy to take a first stab at that. My experience when I speak with people about it is that it's more about a misunderstanding of what addiction is. And so Michael refers so much to how tobacco really used heroin and cocaine and illegal substances that get you really intoxicated as a shield to kind of ridicule the idea that tobacco could be addictive. And they really even tied it to some of the foods they were producing, like, oh, you know, chocolate and tobacco, tobacco is like chocolate, don't say it's addictive. And so often when I speak with people about the current understanding of addiction and that addictive substances don't have to be intoxicating and things that they don't have to have severe withdrawal or intense tolerance. And everything we've learned from tobacco about how something that can be so subtle can really hook people in such a compulsive way. Often I think that changing of the frame makes it seem more reasonable to consider the addiction perspective.
Yeah, I might also, at the risk of repeating myself, I think the use of terminology here is really important. And what we want the focus to be is on, we want the focus to be on the food, not the individual consuming it. And so the term food addiction, one could interpret that as, you know, focusing on the person who's the addict here. Whereas if we talk, for example, of the addictive properties of food, then the focus is clearly on food. And I think we're much more likely to win support for policy change if the focus becomes the food.
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting perspective, Kelly. And the only thing I would add is that I think the ace card for the industry in defending itself is that down deep we all look at Doritos or Ho-Hos or, you know, Captain Crunch cereal and think cute, friendly, fun, you know, our brains recall those childhood memories of Saturday morning cartoons, the advertising. And I think that that's the hurdle many people have to get over in thinking about these food products, which is this industry created, you know, belief in ourselves that these food products are food and they're, you know, and okay, some of them maybe aren't so good for us, but they're hardly evil and diabolical. How could they be? I mean, we've all those cartoon characters. And so I think that at that level, I think that some thought has to be given to how you persuade people to look at these products kind of differently than they look at tobacco and alcohol and narcotics.
Michael, I wonder if some of that might be countered by going back to the tobacco companies marketing specifically to kids. You know, and back then, you know, the Flintstones were marketing Winston cigarettes and the candy cigarettes that the companies were pushing in store aisles and things like that would be an example of something at the time was considered cute, warm, just kind of normative. And maybe we'll change the way we think about the food.
Yeah, too. No. And on the positive side, I think why so many people are looking at addiction from a policy standpoint is that there was such a dramatic change. I mean, in the mid-90s, when enough science convinced jurors that smoking could be addictive for some people, that's when the tobacco companies began losing lawsuits. They were impervious before that. And the reason is that jurors finally realized that this is not our fault. You know, when we smoke to the point of getting cancer, that is not just the smoker's fault. There is also this responsibility on the part of the processed food companies. That's certainly, you know, after my work, what I've come around in thinking too, is that, you know, succumbing, losing control over food products that have these addictive qualities is not our fault as much as it is by, you know, a design by the industry to engineer these products in a way that causes us to lose control.
Yeah, I think the point about food marketing came immediately into my mind, Michael, when you were talking about the cartoon characters and the positive feelings we have that, you know, there's going to be positive feelings about your grandmother's, you know, pie that she made that you loved or the birthday cake. But, you know, these positive feelings about crappy foods like Apple Jacks and Frosted Flakes and things that, you know, are so heavily marketed, McDonald's, you know, that our feeling toward these foods is so much stronger than how tasty and wonderful they really are. So in my own experience as an advocate, the policy that industry most aggressively, with the greatest strength responded to was around food marketing to children. That tiny little policy that I worked with Senator Harkin and Brown back on to just get the government to develop model, totally voluntary guidelines for food marketing to kids. They just pulled out all the stops in order to oppose what was like a very weak toe in the water on food marketing. And then going back to the 1970s with KidVid, they, you know, practically destroyed the Federal Trade Commission. They took away its authority. They took away its money. That I think just, you know, from what you've said and my own experience as an advocate, food marketing could really try to help with some of those, you know, addressing some of those warm, positive feelings that people have that make it hard to believe that these foods are addictive. We have a bunch of questions about some of the risk factors that go along with food addiction. You know, what do we know about socioeconomic factors, the changing workforce, less time to cook, food insecurity, adverse childhood experiences? I think both people asking, you know, how do these affect who's addicted and how do they generally affect food addiction and vulnerability to food addiction societally as well as individually?
Yeah, I'd be happy to take the first stab at that. So we have just been starting to look into food insecurity in my lab with some collaborations. I have a doctoral student, Lindsay Pernauskas, who's taking the lead on this. And we are seeing elevated symptoms of addictive responses to foods in food insecure samples. And when we look at the model of why that might be, you know, we know that these are individuals who are getting kind of swamped with food marketing and ultra processed foods. And that's the only thing they have access to really for their calories. And I think there's a huge social justice issue here as we understand that these foods are not just bad for your health, but that they can hook you in ways that come out of your control. And the unequal access and protections for individuals who are more food insecure, I think is a major outcome of this. If it's not just something bad for you, but addictive, is concerning. And we just have a paper that's under review now looking at childhood trauma in particular and addictive responses to these foods as adults. And we see very strong correlations of the magnitude of 0.6 to 0.7 between early childhood adverse experiences and a greater propensity to experience addictive responses to these foods. So these are really impacting some of our most vulnerable members of society in a way that further diminishes their quality of life.
You're totally right. I mean, I did a story a few years ago of a poor neighborhood in North Philadelphia where the school principal was seeing kids come in the morning, strung out, unable to focus, getting bad grades, and she followed them home, and they were all stopping at the corner stores, which surrounded the school. And so she did an intervention where she got the parents to try to stand on the corner to try to keep the kids from running into the store and coming out, because for $1.06, they could get 350 junk calories. So what was so moving is that the parents were trained by a group that had previously taught them how to fight crack houses in that neighborhood. And here they were standing on the sidewalk. But even for those parents, it was really difficult, because at one point, one of the parents goes into the corner store. She had not had time to make breakfast for her kids and came out with these breakfast bars. And she was so delighted to read in big letters on the front of the breakfast bar, you know, added calcium, thinking that she was making a smart nutritional move by buying that thing, which was basically the equivalent of a Mars bar in terms of nutrition. And all of the elements are sort of in play in that, and absolutely companies. And not only do they exploit people sort of not of economic means, but we saw this during the pandemic, where the companies figured out that, you know, people were getting away from the vending machine by working at home, but the companies figured out how to turn our kitchen cabinets into vending machines by marketing to us during the pandemic in a way that caused us to sort of buy this junk that we hadn't eaten since childhood, and changing the ways that they resupplied the grocery stores to maximize the snacks aisle versus, you know, the flour and the yeast aisle.
Yeah, I mean, concern about children is something that has come up. And, you know, what are the implications of food addiction on children? And how does the exposure to ultra-processed foods early in childhood affect food preferences and their susceptibility to addiction?
You know, Ashley's probably in the best position to note what research has been done on that. But Margo, I think it connects nicely with the earlier point you raised about the industry fighting to protect its ability to market to children in such an aggressive way. And once we know from industry, and maybe Michael knows something about this too, you know, what I suspect they're going to do is there's going to be evidence saying that we need kids as customers. Not only are they buying the food, but we're imprinting on them biologically in some key way through both the marketing and the biological processes created by eating these foods. And, you know, there's that combined with the fact that it's just easier to sell foods that are highly palatable to kids. You know, they could put Tony the Tiger on plain old cornflakes, but they don't do it. Well, why don't they? Because they wanted the kids to eat as much cornflakes as they possibly can. And the way to do that is to put sugar on them. And then the way to get them to want the sugar is to attach Tony the Tiger to them. And if the industry understands that there's some early on biological process that creates an addiction later in life or persists over time, then I think they're highly culpable, both in a legal and a public relations sense.
Well, you know, I think they do know that. And I think what that's called is sort of memory. And sort of, you know, I mentioned how I thought comparing Twinkies to heroin is ludicrous, but and coming around, you know, complete 180 degrees, where I now think that some of these food products are even more problematic to us than smoking or alcohol and maybe some drugs. But one of the ways is the power of memory when it comes to food, because we begin creating food memories at a really early age, possibly even when we're in the womb, depending on what our mother is consuming. And we keep those memories for the rest of our life, unlike, say, smoking or, you know, or alcohol, which tends to sort of, you know, congregate in the late teens and 20s and drug abuse. Food memories are for life, and we associate food memories with other emotions, right? And so that's why the soda companies worked so hard to market in ballparks, knowing that if they can get a soda in the hands of a kid when he or she's with their parents, that soda will forever be associated with that joyous moment in their life for the rest of their lives. And I don't care if it's 40 years later, they're going to remember and associate that soda with that joyful moment. So companies totally know the power of creating memories. And that's what marketing does. It's creating memories in us that then will make us sensitive to cues, as psychologists call us, which is just like that billboard driving down the road.
Yes, I have to say some of the scariest rework about this of doing it is seeing kids. You know, and as Kelly makes the good point, you know, I'm talking about 12% of children meeting kind of that clinical threshold for what would look like an addictive response, a full-blown addictive response. But the average kid is showing 1 to 2 symptoms. So the addictive pull of a substance doesn't just impact that tiny subset of individuals that like fully get clinically addicted. But, you know, we see with kids, they find these foods more reinforcing, these ultra processed foods more than minimally processed foods. They'll work to access them more. They're particularly sensitive to them because they have more sensitive sweet receptors. And the more you get exposed to these foods, you know, you start to show taste plasticity and plasticity in the reward systems of your brain in a way that then when you're exposing them to the apples and the bananas and, you know, the minimally processed foods in the produce station, it just can't compete. And it really reduces, you know, I think what's sometimes politically more palatable is just adding more minimally processed foods into a school, but not actually restricting the marketing and getting some of the ultra processed foods out of the school system. But man, once you start exposing to that, the hedonic, well, the only thing that wakes up the reward centers of your brain and the taste buds on your tongue is that intense level of stimulation that you've gotten accustomed to. And children are particularly prone to that.
Yeah, it's impossible for the apple to compete with the fruit snack, with the character shaped like a character, with the marketing and the sugar. There are a few things about, a few questions and comments about sugar. And we touched on part of this, but can you talk a little bit more about the differences in ultra processed food with respect to sugar sweetened beverages versus sugary, salty, fatty, you know, ultra processed solid foods, the rapidity of absorption? How would you talk about, you know, sugar sweetened beverages compared to other ultra processed foods related to addiction?
Happy to try and take this on quickly because I'm just keeping an eye on our time. So, you know, sugar is probably one of the most potent weapons that the ultra processed industry has. And, you know, I think when we think about liquid calories and sugar sweetened beverages, particularly that are amplified by caffeine, which also has this addictive like profile in our brain. This is so beyond anything that our brains or our bodies evolved to handle. And Michael did made a strong point about the biological mismatch between these sorts of intensely sugary, sweetened, rapidly absorbed substances and what our brains evolved to handle. And that's all drugs are. They're just biologically so intense that they're a mismatch with our biology. And I think when we amp up the sugar and it hits the system so rapidly compared to something like an apple or a banana, it's not just about the sugar, but about how it's optimized to be delivered rapidly and with other additional somatosensory cues and then amplified by fat that doesn't come in nature. So I think that's why I've turned a little bit to the ultra processed, because I think when I think of cigarettes, I think of them as ultra processed cigarettes. You can hand roll your own tobacco. That's not what people were getting addicted to. They were getting to industrialized cigarettes that were engineered to optimize the delivery of nicotine through additives, through somatosensory properties. And that's what these foods, the sugar combined with all the other attributes of an ultra processed food, really just is so hard for us to resist.
I wish we had another hour for questions. I'm going to ask one last question before we turn it back over to Megan to wrap us up. Kelly, there are lots of questions about litigation, comments, and thoughts about it. One, do we have enough evidence on food addiction to move forward with some of the kinds of policies that we had in litigation that we had with tobacco? And if you were going to litigate around food, what would you pick? Which company, which product would you go after?
Well, it's an interesting question, and I think it requires a great deal of thought about which company is selling what. What are their marketing practices? What are the biological effects of the products they're selling and things like that? And my guess is that ultimately it probably won't be a lawsuit against a specific company, but it'll be something like action by the state attorneys general that will say that these products are causing enough, like the state of New York, for example. You know, we have these kind of healthcare costs. So much of that is attributable to bad diet. So much of that is attributable to certain categories of food like sugared beverages, and each company has a particular market share. So you'll apportion the culpability across companies in that way. I suspect that's the way it'll go. And the early lawsuits that were filed, the litigation that was done was very poorly constructed and wasn't well conceptualized. And it was basically individual plaintiffs filing lawsuits against specific companies on behalf of an individual who had suffered some health consequences. And all those kind of lawsuits were completely ineffective in the tobacco arena as well, and no reason to expect they'd be effective in the food arena. But taking action on behalf of a population like a state attorney general could do, I think, is much more likely to be promising.
Well, lots of food for thought today, and good discussion of the issues. Megan, I'm going to turn it over to you to wrap us up.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Margo, Michael, Ashley, and Kelly, for wonderful presentations. It was really an enlightening conversation, and one that I wish we would have had more time in person to get into, as there are so many policy implications and implications for the work and the research we're all doing. So thank you as attendees for joining us today on day 3 of our virtual meeting. I hope you will continue to join us for the final session, the final plenary session tomorrow on policy updates. But I want to call your attention, if you haven't seen already, to virtual posters. This year we are trying something new. We are highlighting the work of several of our grantees via virtual posters. You can find the link on the screen in front of you as well as in the chat box. And we would love for you to check them out and tell us how you feel when you get our meeting evaluation form, which will be sent next week. So as a reminder, this session will be recorded and will be available next week as well. We look forward to sharing with you. Thanks, everyone. Have a wonderful afternoon.